The duration of a lit match, that's every 40 seconds, a person somewhere in this world takes their own life. That's over 1 million suicides a year. I want to take you on a journey into the silence of death, the silence which holds answers to the meaning of life and which shows which path you can take. At the 28th of December 2014 at 9 o'clock in the morning, I, or rather my depression-ridden mind, went down one of those paths. Previously, I posted following lines on Facebook. Silence, the door to the world closes. Silence that protects. Silence until everything fades. Silence. My journey into the stillness of death started with the collapse of my circulation. It felt like a free fall in absolute darkness. No pictures, no thoughts, no emotions, past, present, dissolved. I fell into the black hole of myself. At the same time, my boyfriend, José, was traveling on the motorway. José was the second great love of my life. I was falling in love with him the moment he opened the door on our first date. His deep brown eyes sparkled like crazy, and when he smiled and when he laughed, a huge firework of starlight poured out of his warm eyes. I had never seen something like that in anyone before. And José had in the car suddenly a really strange feeling, and when he couldn't reach me, he raced back. At home, at the same time, I didn't want to kill myself, but my brain made a decision against my free will. I felt like a puppet on strings. Death as a puppet show, and I arrived in the middle of the last act of life until the curtain fell. When José found me, my body was already dark yellow. And finally, I breathed one last time, and breath left my body. When at some point my consciousness returned, the falling had stopped. The supernatural perception of silence was displaced by a faint humming, and the first I felt was a thick tube sticking in my penis. I have been in hospital. José saved my life. But from the age of 16, he gave up his own life, bit by bit. He had suicidal depression, just like his mother and his grandparents. And whenever I said, José, we are old, we can do this and this, José would roll his eyes and say, oh, I don't want to be that old. He refused antidepressant and treatment that would save him, and the elevator of his being hurtled out of control down into hell. And 2.5 years after my own suicide attempt, I was afraid every day by finding José dead in our apartment after return from work. I couldn't take it anymore. And at Easter 2016, we argued, and I told him, either you go to the hospital or we will separate. I cannot live with the daily anxiety anymore, and you have got 4 days to think about it. And then I drove to Berlin. My journey was accompanied by abusive phone calls full of anger until I finally switched off the phone, also full of anger. And when I turned it on again on Easter Monday, about 120 voicemails reached me. José stormed, he raged, he cried, he laughed, he shouted, he promised me each and everything, but he still refused having treatment. And all the while, his voice got quieter and quieter. The last voice made was, "That is the last kiss for you." In a panic, I rang his number again and again, but I couldn't reach him. I typed one text message after another, and I constantly pressed this little I for information until finally a message came in as a relief. Sent, received, and what was most important, read. But who read that message? I still don't know. Jose had been dead for already two days. Suicide. I had hoped from the very first day of our meeting that he would give up his incomprehensible resistance to life. I hoped that love would change everything. But how many hopes does we have in the course of life? How many bitter disappointments do we face because of false hopes? Like children, we define hope as a wish fulfillment machine. But I had lost all hope in God, in life, in universe, in love, in people, and above all, in myself. It took me a year to accept that no one is responsible or to blame for his suicide except the illness of depression. So the first lesson I had to learn was that only acceptance will open new doors. And with this realization, a small spark of hope glowed again, deep in my painful darkness. And the second I learned was that I always had looked at hope the wrong way. Hope is not the belief that wishes will come true. Hope is actually the confidence that we always will overcome whatever the universe or karma will throw at us. Hope means enduring the senselessness of a tragedy, accepting it, finding meaning in it, or developing a meaning of life from it. If you hope, you trust only your inner strength. I no longer hope for anything anymore. I hope only for myself. So if I would give up hope tomorrow, I would give up on myself. This brought me to another important question and aspect of my existence. Who was I? A worker, a big shopping queen, even a bigger party boy, that was me. But after the death of José, my me was replaced by even worse depression, suicidal thoughts, and a lack of perspective. And after a while, I had to ask myself, are you who, or do you just have? Because defining yourself solely by being will promote mental health and will take away any anxiety about the future. This was the third lesson to learn. So, who was I really? Who are you? What makes you tick? What we accumulate in life can be ours, but it can never be the me. If you say, my boat is me, my house is me, my car is me, my partner is me, you are lost. I was lost, always have been. The little having was my breath to be able to live. And when this breath was taken away, when my me and my body were separated and fell apart, the result was my suicide attempt. So I had to recognize and to realign myself afresh through my being. I had to bundle up everything that is 100% Mario and creating from there a meaning of life which is more important than my ego. Because this is the basic building block for happiness and a meaning-centered life. which was the fourth lesson to learn. But how do you do that? Are there any strategies? Well, in my case, life delivered exactly what is needed. It always does. I just couldn't see it, never. But after all these years, I can assure you that you can have a basic trust in every second of your life. The universe always delivers what you need. Never what you want, but always what you need. Perhaps also today, in just one sentence you hear now or later. That's why I had to learn in a fifth lesson to listen to intuition. There has always been a connection between our head, our soul, and our intuition. But we forgot to listen to our intuition, which invariably warns us of the danger and always confirms the good. So, with every decision I took, I listened to myself again. If it felt light, it was right. If it groaned, I didn't do it. And this is something everybody of you can learn. Just practice it with every small or big decision you have to make. If it feels 100% right, doesn't matter how many arguments against it, then simply do it. From then on, I listened only to my heart, without exception. That strengthened my hope too. And in addition, I began to meditate so I could listen better to myself. Silence helped me in that. So to speak, the deathly silence I experienced during my suicide attempt. It became one of the most important and powerful tools of my presence. And hardly any of us knows the silence in our heads, which accompanies us in every minute of our being, which is essential, especially for survival. We never pay attention to it, and therefore we don't experience it. And that's why I want to show you something. Please close for a moment your eyes and take a deep breath and hold it. And now try to make a thought. If you try to think consciously while holding your breath, you will not succeed. It is an empty space between two breaths that expands when we take in our most important elixir of life, oxygen. Ergo, whoever wants to live needs oxygen and silence. And by the way, you can stop holding your breath. Well, in this silence, answers can be found. It is possible to hear oneself and to listen to the pure soul and to get in touch with it, which now and then contacts us on its own accord. 6 months after José's death, that moment arrived when my soul and my being spoke to me out of the silence. Hike around the world, plant trees of memory. Let me help you, it ordered, not daring to contradict me. I really thought I become crazy. But nevertheless, a little later I sat down at a computer and I started to write. Trees of memory, hike around the world, planting trees in memory of suicide victims. Each tree stands for a person who committed suicide. Each tree is a reminder to stop stigmatizing people with depression and to stop sweeping the taboo subject of suicide under the carpet. Each tree stands for a lost relationship, and like love becomes more beautiful the older it gets. And most importantly, each tree stands like a candle in the darkness, as a tree of encouragement to keep the light of hope visibly alive to all those who can't see any further prospects and meaning. And just one day after I wrote that in September 2016, I started to align and to unravel my entire life around it. And since Easter 2018, the second anniversary of José's death, I have been hiking around the world and planting these trees of remembrance. And just as a suicide leaves marks in our souls, this project leaves marks of hope. It connects people who are grieving, who are seeking help, and those who want to help in the tax-free association Trees of Memory. I'm hiking now in my fourth year for hope, for life, and somehow for love. I will not stop until there are Trees of Memory worldwide. And of course, I know none of us can stop the divine motion in which our lives are involved. But however you will do it, please always accept all the circumstances over you have no control. It is the first step to follow your heart and your visions to create a meaning-centered and happy life. Please be a role model for everybody around you. Do you remember the beginning of my speech? Every 40 seconds, someone is taking his own life. These are 28 candles for 28 persons who took their life during the time I was speaking now. Can any of you see the ember in the wick of this candle? No? That's how it is sometimes with the light of hope. Please never ever give up. It doesn't matter how dark it is around you. The light of hope is always part of you like an eternal flame. It just can happen that you don't see it. Always take good care of you. Thanks a lot.